Hello and welcome to the Wormhole Podcast, episode 47. I'm Charlie Place, and joining me today is the best-selling author of many novels about life during the World Wars, and one about the wedding dress of Elizabeth II that sold particularly well. You've probably heard of it, it's called The Gown. Talking today about her latest book, Our Darkest Night. Hello, Jennifer Robson.
Hello, good morning, or good afternoon, as depending on where we both are.
You're morning, I'm afternoon.
Yeah.
So, you've got a lot of books set during the different wars, First and the Second World War. What is it about the subject that interests you?
I think I came to it, first of all, my father, who's now retired, taught history for 40-odd years at two Canadian universities. And his particular area of interest was the Great War and the Second World War. He would talk about them as the crucibles that defined in some ways every aspect of our lives today. And so I grew up, you know, in a house where talking about what happened during the wars, how they changed our world, what it was like to be caught up in those conflicts was a topic of conversation. And then when I went to university, I actually didn't think I would become an historian. One of my courses in my first year at university was European history, and I was fortunate enough to be taught by just an incredible historian called Paul Webb. And I walked out of that first year class thinking, well, that's it. I'm doomed. I'll be a historian. What else can I do with my life? And so I went to graduate school in the UK at Oxford, and there I studied my focus of study, which is so incredibly boring when you read the thesis. That's part of the raison d'être of, I think, doctoral theses, is to be as crushingly dull as possible. But mine was focused primarily on rationing in the Second World War and the effect on women in terms of clothing, how they managed the issue of clothing, especially if you had a ton of kids and they're all growing like weeds. Broadly speaking, just looking to, you know, how the war affected domestic life. And so it had always been an interest of mine. And so when I came to turn, I'd worked as an editor for many years. When I thought I would try writing, I turned my focus to the First World War and wrote, you know, a trilogy of books set in the Great War. And then I thought, well, I'd like to move on a bit. And now I'm in the process of writing my fourth book set, in this case, after the Second World War. And I've gone back and forth between now two books set during that war and two books set after. And it's a toss up to me, which is most interesting. Is it what happens during the conflict itself? Or is it the aftermath of, you know, society kind of emerging from the ashes of the conflict and people taking stock of their lives and trying to figure out what's next? You know, in balance, I think actually sometimes the aftermath of war is the most compelling to me. But in the case of Our Darkest Night, I had to start from day one, effectively.
Well, so, you know, you've introduced the book. Our Darkest Night is about the experience of an Italian Jewish woman in the Second World War, and her father arranged for her to be taken in by a man who's been trained to be a priest to keep her safe. But your idea for this particular book was sparked by a question your son asked you, I believe. Can you tell us about that?
He was, I think he would have been about 13 or 14 at the time. He was studying the Second World War in school. And he had a memory of our having talked about my husband's grandparents and what they did during the war. So he came to me and he simply asked, is it true about Nonna, that's grandmother in Italian, Nonna's mom and dad? Is it true that they helped to save Jewish people during the war? And I had to tell him that we believed it was true. We very much hoped it was true. But that, you know, assessing it as an historian, for example, I couldn't say with my hand over my heart that it absolutely was true. And I felt that was a really disappointing answer to give him. So I started digging. I should add that this also coincided with my becoming really disenchanted with the book I was working on and feeling that it wasn't interesting me. It just wasn't coming to life. The characters felt very flat and dull. And so I quite willingly set it aside and thought it's way more important to answer my son's question. And within a day, I think I realized that the family stories in all likelihood were true, and that those stories were radically more interesting than the book I'd been working on and which will never see the light of day. And so I actually had to call up my editor and say, so change of plans. I'm hoping you're okay with this. And I have this idea, and she embraced it. And so to backtrack a little, my husband and I had been in Italy in 2016, and we're visiting family there in the north. They live about 45 minutes from Venice, if you take the train, for example, to the northwest in the shadow of Monte Grappa, which has long been a central point for conflict in the 20th century and beyond. It's just one of these geographical points, which if you capture it strategically, it's very important. And so it was the site of numerous battles in the First World War, as well as the Second World War. So his family live in the shadow of Monte Grappa in a small town called San Zenone delle Zellini. And it was there they were living, my husband's maternal grandparents, during the war, when their priest, Father Odo Stocco, just an ordinary parish priest, not anyone of any real importance in the church hierarchy, came to them and he asked if they would take in some refugees he was sheltering, Jewish refugees. And they said yes. And so over the next 2.5-3 years, they had a succession of families come and stay with them in their very, very tiny farmhouse that already was housing something like 12 people, but they managed to find space in the farmhouse. And they had some close calls. And after the war, one of the families stayed in touch with my husband's family for a while. But, you know, over the years, the stories faded and the people who had direct memories are almost all gone. It's only one aunt left alive who was alive at the time. My own mother-in-law passed away some years ago. So, you know, we'd had these stories that there were, as my husband's Zia Maria talked about, she talked about her father or my husband's nonno having hidden Jewish people. And that's initially when we discovered this, we were astonished and thrilled to know that this was part of the family story. And I kept meaning to chase down the details and discover if it could possibly be true. And it's not, I should add, that I ever doubted Zia Maria or any of the other family members. It's just, I know from my own experience doing research that memories can shift and change over time and details can morph. So it goes from being something that happened to a neighbor, to then a cousin, to someone who's part of the family. And nobody at any point is consciously not telling the truth. That's just the nature of memory and how it shifts. And it was only really when Matthew prompted me some years later that I thought, well, I will actually chase this down. And really the first and most useful resource were the archives at Yad Vashem in Israel, because it seemed to me that if there were evidence of this priest having led efforts to hide Jews in San Zenone, that it would be in the archives of Yad Vashem, that he or someone associated with it might have been recognized as righteous among the nations, as indeed he was. So Father Odo Stocco was named righteous among the nations in 2010, long after his own death. He died in the 1950s. And it recognized that he had saved more than 50 Jews by finding them hiding places in the village. Along with them, several local families were recognized because there was enough documentary evidence from witnesses, very elderly witnesses, I should add. But they also, the researchers at Yad Vashem also concluded that probably the entire village was in on it, that everyone knew, and that many more people were involved than could be publicly recognized. So at the end of the day, I don't have proof. I still can't say definitively to my son that his grandparents were involved, which really bothered me at first when I came to the dead end and I realized there was no one left alive who could testify or could provide any direct evidence. I mean, my Zia Maria was a little girl when all of this happened. But then I realized that it didn't matter whether or not my husband's family, my family, was involved is actually not important. What is important is that innocent people were saved and their descendants are alive today because of Father Stocco, because of his valor, and because of the ordinary people who chose not to look away.
It's an incredibly compelling story. I was thinking when you're saying all this, I was thinking, obviously, you've got one particular character, Nina, in your story. Mm-hmm. But your story is so much about other people as well.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, the focus needed to be on Nina. And at one point, I considered writing a dual narrative also with Nico's point of view. But I really felt very strongly about all my books that I want the focus to be on women and women's history, women's voices. And Nina's voice to me was compelling. Now, she's entirely fictional. There was no Nina. There are elements of her character and her story that are based on survivors whose memoirs I read. First and foremost is the construction of my imagination. But she's an answer to the question I asked, which is, what must it have been like to have been born Italian, raised as an Italian, fully Italian, and at some point to be told that she was not, in fact, Italian, that she didn't belong, that she was an alien, and that she was not wanted. And that's what happened to the people of Italy, as happened to people all over Europe. You know, to be rejected so profoundly, what must that have been like? And then what must it have been like to then have to go into hiding, to cover up, to obscure some of the things about themselves that were most important and precious to them? First of all, their faith. And to do that, because that was the only way forward to survive. It was extraordinarily difficult to leave Italy in those years. And so most Italian Jews had to find a way of hiding with their neighbors or hiding in plain sight and pretending not to be Jewish. You know, most survived, but nonetheless, something close to 7,000 Italian Jews were sent to the death camps and were murdered there. So while it's a less well-known, you know, broadly speaking, you'd speak of a theater for the Holocaust, nonetheless, there are many individual stories and tragedies that occurred there. And I wanted to capture, you know, one story and set it against the backdrop of, you know, what I've constructed as a fictional place, Mezzocel, rather than Sansanone itself. And while Mezzocel is fictional, it's grounded in truth. The foundations are real, if that makes any sense. You know, I did grapple with, should I set it in Mezzocel and have Father Stocco as one of the real characters? But then speaking with my husband's family, who were incredibly helpful, they thought, well, I would probably get a lot of questions from people who would have it more difficulty discerning the parts that were truthful and the parts that were fictional. And so another one of my husband's aunts, Zia Lucia, said, no, make up a place. People won't get so fussy over the details. And it's true, that way, making up Mezzocel, I could make it exactly as I wanted it to be, as opposed to having to conform to Sansanone, the real place.
Well, that was one thing that I didn't know, that you've made up this place, and I can see you've just told us the process there. Have you had anyone come back and say, well, why did you make a fictional one? Why didn't you use the factual one? Have you had the reverse?
Yeah, no, funnily enough, people haven't. I think probably because, you know, in the end notes of the book, there are maps and explanations that detail my decisions. I think it was also because, and certainly I have friends who write biographical historical fiction that cleave quite closely to the accepted facts and events connected with a person or a certain place. I like to have a little bit of freedom to imagine a little bit more. So in the case of Mezzocel, I wanted somewhere that was farther into the hills. Sansanone is on the plains below Monte Grappa, which is very beautiful. But in terms of descriptions and having people come to and fro, I needed the mountains for plot purposes during the book. Mm. And so there is a real place on the foothills of Monte Grappa called Borso de Grappa. And it is almost right, but not exactly the way I wanted. It doesn't have a central piazza, for example. So Mezzocel is the only place in the book that is not actually real. It gave me the freedom I needed to take the story in interesting ways. And I should add that I don't always know when I start writing how the story will end. And at one point, I did kill off a central character. And I was very committed to doing that for a long time. And it was fairly late in the process of writing the book that I decided I was wrong and that that character needed to live. And I think if I had killed off that character, I would be still be receiving very grumpy emails from people. So I'm glad I didn't. I'm glad I let that person live.
Well, spoiler alert potentially, listeners, then. You might want to skip to the next question in the list of time-stamped questions. Jennifer, was that Nico?
It was, yes. So there's a point in the book where there's a confrontation with him and Berger, at the end of which, you know, Nico is very badly beaten and hauled off to who knows where. And the original version of that scene has him being shot in front of my heroine, Nina. And it was a very affecting scene, I have to say. I wept. Oh, my goodness, did I cry when I was writing it. And my editor wept. My literary agent, we all cried. And then we had a long discussion and we realized that I couldn't keep it in the book because it just was so depressing. And I was finishing writing the book, I should add, right at the height of the kind of the first wave of the pandemic. And as much as earlier on, I've been committed to the idea of being quite unflinching about it, I just couldn't see it through. It was too depressing.
Well, that's interesting to hear, because I thought it was interesting how later in the book you have a moment where Nico's probably killed or possibly killed.
Yeah.
In a different scene. And I was wondering what you were going to do with that, because it was just so shocking in itself. I thought, goodness, I mean, the book does take a turn after that.
Yeah.
But that itself was quite a turn. And then I thought, you know, it might be there's something else going on here, given Zwerger's personality.
Mm-hmm.
But did that decision to kind of work that in come afterwards then? And then you kind of went on from there.
It did. In that, you know, I still had, Zwerger is a Nazi, is unrepentant Nazi. And interestingly, you know, one of the strangest pieces of reader mail, and I've had, you know, overwhelmingly this book, people have sent lovely, lovely messages. Many people who have connections, their families were caught up in the Holocaust, or people who are Italian and who have memories that are strikingly similar to some of the scenes I describe in the book. But I did get a very strange email from someone who thought I was too hard on the Nazis, which I did not dignify with the response. And I'm still disgusted. I'm not surprised, but I'm disgusted that someone would feel that way. I do differentiate, I should add, in the book between ordinary Germans who were caught up in this nightmare and who themselves may not have been supporters of the National Socialists or Hitler or any of it. Not actual Nazis. I mean, there's a distinction. I'm quite clear about that. But Berger himself is sadistic. He's clearly a psychopath, very high functioning psychopath, but he is. And he deliberately, you know, uses his position of power not only to injure, but to psychologically abuse people who, you know, have the misfortune to cross paths with him. And that includes both Nico and Nina. There's so many moments when I was writing it, this book, where I doubted myself and I was worried that what I was writing would be upsetting. I don't have a problem with making somebody cry, especially if it's a good cry. Sometimes a good cry when you're reading a book is wonderfully cathartic, but I didn't want to traumatize anybody. And I certainly went back and forth with my editor so often, and also with a number of sensitivity readers to ensure that I was being true to the history, true to the very, very real and unquestionable suffering of the innocent people who were caught up in the Holocaust. But at the same time, not turning the book into some kind of bludgeon to hit readers with. And so where I found my way was in cleaving to Nina's point of view. So we only see what she can see. So yes, she does have some very tough experiences, but she isn't in the moment able to speculate necessarily as to what the larger picture is. She has no knowledge of the totality of violence and horror. And so I think in some ways that was what made it tolerable for me to write, and I hope for people to read, particularly since Nina survives, not without scars. Nobody lived through that war, and particularly the Holocaust, without some level of trauma, but she survived. It was really important to me that she emerged in triumph to a certain degree. And I needed that. I have to say, you know, the year before last, in the spring of 2020, when I was finishing this book, I really needed that. I don't think I could have, it just would have been just misery making to have had a book where it ended and Nina was completely victimized and miserable. And I needed something to elevate the book. And I think what elevated it in the end was hope, which she clings on to.
Mm-hmm. You were saying about that she had to survive. It was so powerful there that I know I was sitting there thinking, is she going to? Which
yeah.
She may have needed to, but I think the fact that you do question, is she going to, was so powerful itself.
You know, writing a book is a series of decisions. And you get to these crossroads and say, do I go left? Do I go right? How do I respond to this crisis that I'm putting my readers first, but initially my central character? And, you know, having decided to write about the Holocaust and to face it, to really write a story fully about the Holocaust, I had to face up to the fact that Nina was going to have some terrible, terrible days, and that I was going to have to write about one of the worst places ever to exist, which is Birkenau. I found it extraordinarily difficult. I went there just before the pandemic kind of shut everything down. So this would be January 2020. I'd written a lot of the book, but I couldn't write the later scenes without going to Poland and seeing for myself, even though obviously what exists currently at the memorial site at Auschwitz-Birkenau is not what Nina would have seen, obviously. But I just didn't feel I deserved to write about the book unless I had gone there and somehow tried to honor the memory of the people who did go, just to stand there and recognize it, to have my feet on that ground. It's kind of an ineffable thing, but I had to do it. And so we started our trip in Venice, and I had the help of an incredible academic guide there called Chiara Ponchia. There isn't anything about the Jewish quarter in Venice that she doesn't know. She was just wonderfully helpful. And then we went out to San Zanone, to Borso da Grappa, to the countryside, just so I could, again, we've been there a number of times to visit family, but this time I was going and trying to see things through the eyes of Nina. Then we took the train north to Austria, across the Brenner Pass, and then from there through the Czech Republic and to Poland, to Krakow. And again, in no way am I comparing my going on the train to what people went through when they were transported in such horrific conditions. What I wanted to do was get a sense of the distance of how far it was, which I didn't think I would get if we flew there, for example. And I was astonished by how far it was to make that journey and to see the countryside changing, things like that I needed to take in. And then again, to stand there and to reflect on what had happened to the millions of innocent people who were murdered across Europe. It was such a humbling moment. And I know people complain about the crowds at some of the big memorial sites and so on. And certainly I saw some shocking behavior in terms of people just not understanding that it is a memorial site that's the last resting place for hundreds of thousands of people. And I was frankly quite disgusted by some of the behavior I saw from people. It was all about taking photographs and acting silly, and that was very disappointing. But I found when my husband and I could kind of move away from the crowds a little bit and find these moments of stillness, that's when the weight of it really descended. And I felt like I was able to hear, which again, I know sounds a little bit woo-woo, but writing these books is, for me, it's connecting people today with people who lived in the past. Their lives mattered. And that's ultimately what I'm trying to show in these books. Past world that is gone, but I'm hoping is not forgotten.
Well, there's something very different to knowing the facts and reading a textbook about what happened, and then reading your book where you've got the character right there, where the people mm-hmm. are being split up, and it's this tiny group of people that are remaining.
Yeah.
That, I mean, just think about it now, I'm struggling to talk a little bit because it was just so,
yeah.
You can know it so much, and you can hear it and hear it and hear it, but that was just such a powerful moment, you know. Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I was hoping to show people. What I find too, and this is where, you know, my background as an historian, and it comes up again, it's really easy, as historians, we do it all the time, to start throwing numbers at people. And the statistics are numbing. Our brains can't absorb the reality of what 100,000 people means, what a million people means. It's very hard to grasp that in any sense. And in some ways, although I think it's very important that we be crystal clear about just how many people were abused and murdered, I think people need to know that. But what we also need to know is that each one of those people, they were individuals, they were unique, which goes without saying in some ways, but I think it's easy to forget that each person who was murdered, they were a world. They were a world of experiences and memories and dreams and hopes and love. And just to let their individual stories be subsumed into the larger horror, sometimes it's useful to go back and just take one story, just one story, and follow it through. And I suspect that in some ways that's more powerful to the average person than being lectured about the grand sweeping scenes. It's the people that matter.
Nina's father has a strong reason for staying behind his wife. Were there many people that chose to stay behind and not leave?
Yeah. There's an example, the chief rabbi of Venice, Rabbi Ottolenghi. He could have left. He had any number of opportunities to escape, but he would not leave his elderly parishioners, effectively. The people, especially in the Casa di Riposo, he felt he had to stay and help take care of them. So he remained in Venice. He too was arrested and deported with the other residents of the Casa, and he was murdered along with them at Birkenau. And you see it again and again. People who could have left and who were very aware of what faced them. The very least that anyone could imagine was that they were being sent to some horrendous work farm or prison. Of all the things they could imagine, that was probably the best outcome. And even though very few people had any knowledge of the breadth and depth of what was happening on at the extermination camp, there was still kind of a sense, without at that stage a lot of material evidence, that terrible things were happening in remote parts of Eastern Europe, and that to be deported from where you were living was effectively a death sentence. One thing I reject, and sometimes you see it in narratives, is that people were uncomprehending or that they didn't resist. I just think that's a failure of imagination on the part of people who are critical of the victims of the Holocaust, because the whole thing was so difficult to comprehend and so hard to wrap your mind around the horror of what was happening. It was very hard to mount any kind of a protest or to resist. And that's one of the ways that led to so many people being captured and murdered. But people knew it was bad. And, you know, if you had elderly relatives, if you had little children, where could you go? Where could you go? Across the mountains to be captured or shot on sight or sent back by the Swiss at the border? It strikes me that a lot of the criticisms, you know, ridiculous kind of historical objections to, say, people's behavior at times like that, they align with modern day criticisms of refugees, which I find horrifying, which is to criticize people who actually have the courage to leave a terrifying place and to strike out for the unknown. And it just beggars belief that those of us who are living comfortably in places where we don't have to fear bombs falling or the secret police coming to get us, that we would ever criticize anyone who has lived under a regime where that happens. That's what I do with my work. I try and put myself in the shoes of people who are having both the best days of their life and the worst. I just find other people are endlessly interesting. And I don't say this in the sense of someone who's curious in a kind of a probing way. I just find other people really interesting.
You've got a ton of books left in you, haven't you?
I feel like I do. It's funnily enough, I only ever have the book I'm writing on and then one ahead of it that I can imagine.
That's wonderful. Really wonderful. The farm life, the time on the farm. Mm-hmm. Did much change for farmers in Europe? What kind of, if you could tell us how you came to write about the farm.
So a lot of that came from my husband, who grew up with stories from his parents. They grew up on farms. And in fact, the farmhouse that I described that the Girardi family lives in is really a composite of the quite large and somewhat grand farmhouse that my father-in-law grew up in. It was a beautiful building, still owned by a cousin. And then the much more humble house where my mother-in-law grew up in, which was the place where they had people who were in hiding, stayed with them. And so there were always the stories. And even when my parents-in-law were alive, I loved hearing stories of what it was like on the farm. And then to add to that, I then did long-form interviews with my husband's surviving aunts and uncles, most of whom are from the other side of the family. And a number of them are still alive. And so I spoke with them, and their stories were just fascinating, just the life they led and the simplicity of it. And most of all, the work. I knew the minute I became part of Claudio's family, I knew that his parents were the kind of people who were defined by work. They were not content with just sitting and watching TV. They're both retired, but you wouldn't know it from going over to their house. You know, they lived in the suburbs of Toronto and had a massive, massive vegetable garden and kept chickens till the end of their lives. And probably if it were legal, would have kept more animals. But the city of Mississauga in Ontario is quite picky about the number of farm animals you can have. And I think three chickens, for example, is really it. Otherwise, who knows, there might have been a pig in the back garden. They just work. That was what defined them. And so just talking with Zia Lucia, Zio Guarino, and the other Z, less formally, their description of what it was like as children, as little kids, they were out. As soon as you were old enough to distinguish one type of plant from another, you're old enough to go out and weed the field. So from when they were very little, and we're talking 3 or 4 years old, they would work. That's how people got fed. And a lot of the work was, you know, when they had to bring in the hay, it was, you know, you're using a scythe and you're gathering it by hand. That's never not going to be really, really taxing. The cows were milked by hand. All of that. Threshing the grain. You know, you would get up at dawn and you'd fall into bed not long after dusk and be exhausted. And then you would get up and do it again the next day. And I grew up in a small, very, very small hamlet, really, outside Peterborough, Ontario. And all of our neighbors were farmers. So I was well aware of the rhythms of farm life. But I hope I also was able to capture, there's beauty in it as well. Beauty in the land, you're feeding yourself, and the simplicity of it can be beautiful as well. So all of this, it really came from family memories. And then, you know, I did some additional research into things like the Amasi, where Mussolini's fascist government really was tithing farmers. And so, you know, large portions of what they grew were taken by the government and then resold at a premium to the public. And so that was very punitive. And I think in large part is one of the reasons that the fascists were so deeply unpopular in the north of Italy and in a lot of farming areas by the time the mid-1940s rolled around.
There is a question that has been brewing in the background subtly, I think, from the first moment that we started talking. What are you writing at the moment? Can you tell us about what's next?
Yeah, I'm back to the UK for this book. It's set in 1953. It's called Coronation Year. And the backdrop is, of course, the coronation of the Queen. And it is set at a little hotel that's quite ancient in near Charing Cross called the Blue Lion. And it follows the proprietor, a young woman called Edie Howard, and her guests over the course of what is effectively 6 months, really. Coronation year is just the first half of the year, really. And as they get ready for the coronation day, and more specifically for them, the coronation procession will go past the hotel. There's a legend attached to the hotel to do with an ancient crown that was thought to have been lost at the time of the English Civil War, but may in fact still be lurking on the premises of this hotel. That's the book, and I'm hoping it will be coming out in the very beginning of 2023. So so just in time for the 70th anniversary, not the Jubilee, which is the year before, but the 70th anniversary of the coronation itself.
A lot of work then. I was expecting you to say maybe next year.
I'd hoped for it to be done for next year. And then it's surprising how just the research process slows down a lot without being able to travel. And I just wanted to take my time on this book. When I first started writing, I was turning out a book a year. And I look back and I think, I have no idea how I managed that. And if the strange year and a half has taught me anything, it's that we all need some level of balance in our lives. And so I'm trying to be better at balancing work, which I love, and everything else, including children who are teenagers now. They were little when I started writing. They're teenagers now. One is off to university next year. And I had a sudden realization that I'm going to blink and they'll be gone. And I want to really focus on my kids as well.
Well, Jennifer, it has been lovely talking to you today. These difficult conversations, you know, they're not wonderful, but it's been good, it's been important, and thank you for sharing all those stories with us. Thank you for being here today.
Thank you so much.
Links to purchase Our Darkest Night are in the episode description. If you have enjoyed our conversation, do subscribe or follow for future episodes. And join me on Monday, the 25th of October, when I will be talking to Rosie Travers, author of The Theatre of Dreams. The Wormhole Podcast, episode 47, was recorded on the 15th of September and published on the 11th of October, 2021. Music and production by Charlie Place.